Igniter at the 5-second mark, and if the igniter's confirmed operating, open the thrust valves at zero. We're expecting a burn to depletion on the oxidizer tank, which should last about 5 seconds if all goes well.
At MIT, we're challenged every day with our problem sets, projects, and exams. There have been many, many late nights. But what gets you through it all are those moments where you get a chance to escape.
Our camera's rolling. Everyone ready to go? Okay. Alright, we're gonna pressurize the propellant tanks.
Those moments where you're able to do what you're passionate about, de-stress, get excited, and gain that perspective as to why you're doing this all to begin with.
Okay, and tanks, both tanks are holding 800 PSI.
Yeah, we're pretty busy here as aerospace engineering students, but we have really cool people here and we have the facilities, so why not start a tech YouTube channel? And why not build a rocket engine and test fire it in Southern California?
Okay, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, start igniter, 3, 2, 1.
Hi guys, it's KJ, the MIT Tech Guy here, and if you're new to my Day in the Life with MIT Student Series, it's a series where I show you what I do on a daily basis, and also give you some honest insight as to what life as an MIT aerospace engineering student is like. As I mentioned in an earlier video, I'm still in IAP, or MIT's Independent Activity Period, where basically we get the whole month of January off, and we can do anything from just go home, go to class, or test a rocket engine. Today I came out to the desert to see Sam test fire his rocket engine that he's been working really hard on for quite some time now. It's actually very impressive, and he's solely responsible for everything from ordering all of the necessary parts and supplies to manufacturing every piece, even the bolt holes. He was even able to use his knowledge from thermo, fluids, and structures to really crunch the numbers and make sure everything was going to work here at the test site. He flew all the way out here from Southern California for this very test, and I think he's really proud of everything he's been able to accomplish.
I'm excited and a bit nervous. Like, we don't know what's gonna happen. This is a completely new set of hardware. But the thing is, the test stand has been tested before. We've used it before. And it's the same I-beam, same place. So there's some unknowns and there's some new things, but we're just gonna see what happens.
So I had this trip on the calendar for several months. You know, I planned this back in September or October when, you know, of course the engine and everything wasn't done yet. So I sort of had to progress with this faith that I would get the engine, get all the hardware done before that date arrived. And I think back to when I was flying out to California and I was on the plane, the engine had made it through security. It was like 7 a.m, I was super tired, but I could just sort of sit back and relax knowing that everything I had done to this point had paid off so far. I was on my way to California and I could look forward to what lies ahead.
The desert is a great place to test rockets because there's nothing around that we or the rocket itself can harm. So right now the site is used a lot by rocket lovers like Sam to test their rockets. Quite a bit of people actually came to see Sam fire his engine because we all knew how important it was to him. Also, the man made a rocket engine himself, and that's really cool.
So this is a liquid propellant rocket engine, meaning that the fuel and oxidizer, the propellants, are stored and injected into the combustion chamber as liquids. For the fuel, I'm using kerosene. Kerosene is super cheap, really easily available, has a high energy, and is also a very common propellant among commercial and amateur liquid rocket engines alike. For the oxidizer, I'm using liquid oxygen. Liquid oxygen is very cold, it's a cryogenic fluid, and it's an incredibly good oxidizer.
We're just putting a little bit of sealant here. So there's a hole in the side of the combustion chamber that I'm put a pressure sensor in to sense the chamber pressure. And so I've just put a little sealant in there to make sure the gases don't escape.
When the gases leave the exit plane of the rocket engine, they're traveling over 6,000 miles an hour and they're over half the temperature of the sun. You can just imagine the amount of energy that the combustion reaction releases. And that energy is used to produce useful thrust through this rocket nozzle.
So what's left, Sam?
So it's about 2 o'clock and we just need to do some final checks on the test stand electrical control system. So we just hooked everything up and there's an issue with two of the valves. One's the valve for pressurizing the propellant tanks. The other's an issue with the valve for venting the fuel tank. Those valves, for some reason, when we flip the switch, I don't hear the click of the relay signifying that it's actually actuated. However, we did just do an ignition test of the igniter. The igniter appears to be working good and should be pretty good for the test. So at this point, we're waiting for UCLA. They're doing some final checks on their test stand to see if they can actually fire today or if they have to stand down. And then once they're clear their test stand, then we'll go out there and finish debugging. We got a trusty old multimeter in hand, so we'll see if we can make this work. You know, I think it would help if you plug this in.
We sort of debugged some problems, and it came down to missing an Ethernet cable. I forgot to plug in the cable from the switch box into the test stand. So sometimes it just comes down to small issues like that. Make sure you read your checklists.
Okay, activate your oxidizer vent valve. 3, 2, 1. And I'm gonna ask someone to actuate the main press valve. Clear, so let's actuate the press valve.
PV?
Yes, PV. Cool. All right. Ready to load propellants. Lock fill valve is open. Vent valve is open. I think we're ready to fill. Let's start slow. It's gonna, most of it, I mean, you know it's gonna flash off.
Press off this. Turn it off.
It takes a little while because it's all cryo right now. So the whole tank has to come up to pressure.
So when you're loading propellant to the test stand, you've finished your final checks. You've finished the control system checkouts and you made sure all the valves are working, you're almost ready to test. And as I'm sitting there, I'm just thinking of all the different things that could go wrong. There's so many of them. You could have contamination of the propellant line. You could have some leak in the propellant line. Your chamber could suffer an overpressure at startup. But as I'm thinking of these things, I'm also thinking about the fact that I'm 3,000 miles from home and I have one shot at this moment on this winter afternoon in Southern California. And I'm thinking that I wouldn't be here if I hadn't prepared myself for the past several months for this one day, and for putting my best foot forward through my best work and every single machining operation, every calculation, every part that was made was really done with the best that I can offer. And I think that's the best that anyone can do. The fact that we're at MIT and we're given these opportunities makes you realize why not put your best foot forward? Why not put in the best work that you can offer every single day? I walk down the infinite corridor or to my classes. I'm just surrounded by these awesome people, awesome opportunities. And it just makes me want to take advantage of all of them. If you don't have the time to do it correctly, when are you going to find the time to do it over again? Time is precious.
Our AeroAstro department is known to really challenge its students by throwing them into the fire in projects and problem sets. During our sophomore year, we had 2-semester-long projects that we worked on in small, randomly assigned teams. The first semester, we had to optimize a water-powered rocket to carry as much payload as possible to fly at least 90 meters. During the second semester, we built large remote-controlled airplanes from scratch with the purpose of delivering pizza. We had to optimize the planes to carry the most pizza slices as possible. I personally didn't know how to optimize on MATLAB or how to use a foam cutter to cut wings, but we had a task to get done, so we learned along the way and ended up with 2 successful projects that we can pride ourselves in having built. So when Sam's thousands of miles away and really only has one shot to get this right, he can stay confident knowing that whatever may go wrong, he has the tools to troubleshoot the issues.
Aux drain valve is closed, fuel drain valve is closed, thrust valve is closed, igniter's installed. We're gonna crank open the K-bottle to full. Okay, so we should have full flow from the K-bottle.
And I think we just knew we were ready to fire.
At the 5-second mark, and if the igniter is confirmed operating, open the thrust valves at 0. We're expecting a burn to depletion on the oxidizer tank, which should last about 5 seconds if all goes well. Our camera's rolling?
Yep.
Everyone ready to go? Okay. All right, we're gonna pressurize the propellant tanks. Okay, and both tanks are holding 800 PSI. Okay, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, start igniter, 3, 2, 1, ignition.
Some people ask me if it's worth it. The thousands of dollars, the late nights in the machine shop, the trip all the way out here, just for 3 seconds of fire. But I think the feeling of doing all the calculations, checking the calculations, machining the parts, assembling the engine, bringing out to this test stand, and then watching it erupt in this brilliant display of energy, this release of energy, the fire, the smoke, and the pressure. You could feel the shock waves hitting you during the operation. And I think that feeling is pretty incredible. It's just, it's worth every penny.
3, 2, 1, ignition! Test stand is safe! We got it!
Good job, man.
Okay. All right, we got it.
Awesome.
Okay, dude. There we go, there we go. Oh my gosh.
Oh my gosh.
Nice job, buddy. Okay.
I don't believe it. That was so great.
Oh man, I'm just grounded
here. Oh yeah.
You got
oh,
it.
Oh man.
I know I wanted to.
Okay, there we go, guys.
How do you feel?
It's incredible. I mean, I just, there's so many things that can go wrong with this type of project, and I mean, I was sort of thinking through those things my last few seconds. I can't believe it.
Surviving the rigor of MIT's aerospace engineering program or any other rigorous program at other schools takes a lot of self-awareness. Self-awareness as to when to take a nap, when to eat, and when to just take a break. But it also involves having the self-awareness to know what you're actually passionate about. Outside of simply finding an academic field you're passionate about to major in, finding something that you can do outside of classes that you're really passionate about will help you navigate those really stressful times. For me, I've said I really enjoy playing basketball. I enjoy encountering new technologies and making videos about them. For Sam, he enjoys running and he really does love rockets. So he joined MIT's rocket team, became a leader on the team, and even started his own projects like this one. And to him, rockets are something that he can focus on and have fun with outside of class, where there aren't any extra grades attached to worry about. It sounds kind of weird to say, but I think he's really at peace when he's working on rockets. And I can only imagine how proud and accomplished he felt when he completed a project like he did that day. If you want to see more of a behind the scenes of how he made his rocket, he will be posting a recap video soon, and I'll have that in the description when that's out. So if you're in school right now, understand that if you're not in the right mental state to tackle a rigorous class at that moment, you just will struggle even more. Go out and find something you're really passionate about, whether it's playing sports, dancing, or building rockets. At the end of the day, you'll feel better, and you'll be in the right mental state to actually be equipped to take on those rigorous classes. This YouTube channel means a lot more to me than the money or fame that it'll produce. It gives me a chance to escape the stresses of school temporarily. I can temporarily shift my attention to the latest and greatest tech products that I'm fascinated about, and I can learn a lot about them, and create some awesome videos for people all around the world to enjoy. Making and planning these videos really takes a lot of time, but I would spend all that time over again because of how fulfilling it is. Find what you really love to do, go pursue it, and you'll inevitably meet some amazing people who share similar passions to you. With YouTube, I've gotten the chance to meet I Justine, Jaime Rivera, Michael Fisher, and so many genuine and nice company representatives who have given me the opportunity to go to launch events and review new tech that I've always been interested in. In Sam's case, he has created lifelong friendships through rocketry, and he has also been able to use his rocket knowledge in his internships at SpaceX. So that's it. I hope you really enjoyed episode 4 of A Day in the Life of an MIT Aerospace Engineering Student. I worked really hard on this video, so if you liked it, it would mean a lot to like this video and also share it to some people that you think would find this video interesting. If you haven't already, follow me on Instagram and Twitter and DM me on those platforms, and I'll try to get back to you as soon as possible. As for this channel, I have a lot of really cool videos planned, so make sure you're subscribed and have the notification bell clicked. As always, thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next video.
Have to be your biggest fan. And when things are really tough and they're really rough and nothing's working, but there's something inside of you that says, I just have to follow that. Because you don't know who you're gonna meet, who you're gonna meet, who you're gonna meet.